Morning, Eastside. Welcome to Eastside, where we are about seeking Christ, serving the community together, teaching others, and joining in worship. During this time, everything you need to know is right here on the website. We have some special COVID information. We have other information about our SENT campaign, our new facility that we are hoping to move towards, and the information regarding that. The simplest way for you to get in contact with us is to send an email to connect@eastsideharrisonburg.org. Whether this is your first Sunday or you've been here for the last 10 years, send an email here, and that's the best way to get in touch with us, and we can answer your questions. If you are a first-time attender, or you'd like to get to know us better at Eastside, we would love to get to know you as well. And so send an email here. We'll schedule a time where we can talk about what is Eastside doing, where are we going, and how we can get you connected with small groups and other information. Speaking of other things that we're doing throughout the week, this is what we do on a weekly basis. You'll notice a couple of key changes today because there's some key and exciting things happening at Eastside. You'll notice Mondays with Mia, she schedules Zoom calls with kids from pre-K to kindergarten, kindergarten to second grade, and then third through fifth grade. Those are great times to not only connect with Mia, our children's director, connect with teachers, but then, of course, for the kids to get to connect with each other. They're really loving that. Wednesday, this is a special week. We are going to be on the move for a time of prayer, and we'll share a little bit of information with you next slide, but that's going to be this Wednesday from 6:30 to 7. Thursday, we have a Bible study at noon on Zoom. On Friday, we usually share just a weekly update of a family member and what God's doing in their family. And then, of course, on Sunday, we have worship. And then we always have communion at noon. The information is there. And this coming weekend, we will also be having a voting affirmation weekend where we will be looking for feedback about the potential new facility that we're looking to purchase for what's next. Speaking of that, this Wednesday, we are going to be having essentially a progressive prayer time. We're going to start together at 6:30 at Skyline Middle School. There's four stops along the way, and then we will end up at our new location, 1060 South Main Street, where we also then will have a time of prayer in that. So you get information about that. If you don't get information, connect@eastsideharrisonburg.org. We'll get you the itinerary. What we're going to do is we have five stops, and each of the stops has some prayer points and even a worship song that you can play while you pray together. We'll be in different cars. We'll be socially distant, and you'll be able to go separately together with a whole bunch of other people that are going separately, and then we'll start at Skyline, end at the hopeful new facility, and if you have a mask, you actually can walk around inside the facility and pray in the facility as well. We're really excited about the opportunity to pray as well. So that's all I have for us today. Looking forward to a time of worship with Mitch and Lauren, who are our interim worship directors. So I'm going to send it over to them, and then I'll see you back after that.
Good morning and welcome to another Sunday service with Eastside. We're going to jump right into worship today, starting with the bridge of who you say I am, as we're doing for each Sunday of this series, Holy and Called.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Oh, I am who you say I am. Hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. And I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
I hope that you were able to feel that truth this morning as we worship together, that death is defeated and the King is alive. Because when Jesus died, rose again, and ascended to heaven, he didn't leave us here to fend for ourselves without help. Through the gift of the Holy Spirit, we have God's wisdom and direction always for everything we think, say, and do. Today's worship goal is to point to the character and quality of the Holy Spirit. That goal comes from Eastside's mission statement for corporate worship. And I want to take a moment to share that mission statement with you and speak a little bit about my role as interim worship director. Part of my role is to help set the stage for whoever might come in as a permanent worship director after me. And I think that part of accomplishing that is putting this mission statement at the front and center. So I'd like to read it for you. It says, "Corporate worship at Eastside expresses and points to the character and quality of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It identifies our right relationship with Him. That is, it identifies God's glory, our falling short, and yet our right relationship through Christ. It transforms and unites the family through communal practice. It energizes people, and it reflects a kingdom far greater than any one individual, congregation, or culture. God is the reason we worship." That mission statement was created within the last year by a group of people at Eastside who sat down and looked at what corporate worship should do for our family. We know that worship is a part of every aspect of our lives, but the time we spend together in the same place singing the same songs is unique. And we want to make sure that these are the things that we are doing so that our time together is moving us forward in the best possible way for our church formation. My goal as worship director is to keep this mission statement in front of us so that we can talk through it together and sing through it together and hopefully unite behind it as our reasons for worshiping together at Eastside. I know that we're not going to get 100% unity in terms of every person liking every song every week. It's not how music works. But I think we can become united behind this mission statement. And if we can do that, then song selection and style become secondary, because we know why we are together and we can worship with the people around us working towards the same goals. So Lauren and I are going to do our best to use this as the framework for the work that we're doing through screens. And hopefully, if we ever get back together, leading you in person as well. You've probably noticed that this time through screens is different. Things don't feel quite as cohesive. Lauren and I are recording our videos after our kids are in bed, so it might take us a few nights to get the videos together, so we're not doing it all in one take. You might see us reusing videos from prior weeks if they're well done and they fit with the message. But everything we're doing, we're going to try to use this mission statement as a framework. It's part of the reason that we sing some songs in Spanish or other languages to reflect a kingdom that's far greater than any one culture. It's part of the reason that we sing some hymns and some contemporary songs, because worship should energize people, and different people are energized by different things. So the decisions that we're making, I hope, will come from this mission statement, so that we can work together as a church to all be on the same page. Because regardless of all of those details, those goals, God is the reason that we worship. And I pray that our time together will be a time where you can worship God simply because of who He is.
Thank you.
as one mighty choir sing our hymn of praise to you. Burn away our wasted sadness and inflame us with your love. Burst upon your congregation, give us gladness from Spirit, bring your message, burn and breathe each word anew. Deep into our tired living, till we strive your work to do. Teach us love and trusting kindness, lend our hands to those who hurt. Breathe upon your congregation and inspire us with your word. Breathe upon your congregation and inspire us with your word.
Thanks, Mitch and Lauren. It's always good to join together in worship. Well, we are in the third Sunday of our Holy and Called sermon series. It's a walk through 1 Corinthians. It's what we're going to be doing the rest of the summer. And so, yeah, I hope you're enjoying it with us. Before we jump in, I've asked Lirian to read scripture for us this morning. So if you would stand for the reading of the word, we can read together.
Hi, Eastside. God bless you. Dios le bendiga. If you can please stand. Pastor Peter asked me to read 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 6, throughout 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 4. We do, however, speak a message of wisdom among the mature, but not the wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. No, we declare God's wisdom, a mystery that has been hidden and that God destined for our glory before time began. None of the rulers of this age understood it. For if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. However, as is written, what not eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things God has prepared for those who love him. These are the things God has revealed to us by his Spirit. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. For who knows a person's thoughts except their own spirit within them? In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. What we have received is not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, so that we may understand what God has freely given us. This is what we speak, not in words taught us by human wisdom, but in words taught by the Spirit, explaining spiritual realities with Spirit-taught words. The person without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, but considers them foolishness, and cannot understand them because they are discerned only throughout the Spirit. The person with the Spirit makes judgments about all things, but such a person is not subject to merely human judgments, for who has known the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? Brothers and sisters, I cannot address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you were not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly. For since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere humans? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not mere human beings?
Thanks, Livian. Yeah, we are in this 1 Corinthians sermon series. We're excited for it. We're going to jump right in today. And so as we do that, I just want to take some time to pray for this morning. God, we thank you for today. Whether it's Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, whatever day it is that we are joining together in worship with our family, we thank you for the opportunity to gather in worship. God, we thank you that you are the same from the beginning, before the foundations of the earth, to now, and to when you come again to rule and reign. God, we are your body. It is our desire to be filled with you so that we might know your mind, that your heart would become our heart, or that our hearts would become more and more like yours. God, we need your help in this world. We need your help in our lives. We need your help in all that we say and do. God, we give you this time. God, build us up through the study and the reading and the time spent reflecting on your word today. And all God's people said, amen. All right, we're getting into it now. 1 Corinthians is a response, sort of a call and response from Paul to a very real church going through very real details. And today we're going to get into the heart of it. This letter that Paul is writing is a response to an issue. Essentially, what the church of Corinth was saying in this section is, you didn't give us, Paul, you didn't give us the special information that the other knowledge teachers did. You held out on us, either because you didn't know, you didn't teach it right, or you didn't want to share it with us. And so what happened is the issue was wisdom. There was this argument that rose up within the body of the church in the city against each other and against Paul and against some other teachers. And there was these disagreements. And essentially the disagreement was about wisdom, spiritual wisdom, maturity. Now, this isn't something, an abstract idea. Culturally, the idea of wisdom, Matt has talked about this already, but culturally, the idea of wisdom was something that was of value to the church. It was of value to the broader city of Corinth. And if we would flash forward to where we live today, wisdom is something of value that we have today. Where does wisdom come from? What does it mean to have wisdom? As followers of Jesus, most importantly, what does it mean to have spiritual wisdom? Is there a difference? So that's what this debate is about. Now, if you've read any of Paul's letters, you know how Paul does things. Paul's regular approach to the debates is like this. He starts off, "Oh, yes, I see your point." And he continues to kind of work his way around in it. And he's humble. He's simple. He puts himself down. And he gets sort of this broad playing field where he's covered all of the bases. And then he pulls, not a sucker punch, but he reels them in like a fish, giving them lots of line. And then, bam, he pulls them in. And he goes at them hard. And he goes at them strong, and he basically destroys and obliterates their arguments. When he's writing to the church in Galatia, if you'll remember this argument, you might have to put earmuffs on the kids, but there's an argument about circumcision, and he wheels them in, and he's very nice, and then he rounds the corner, and bam, he says, "I wish you'd just castrate yourself." There's this argument about his conversation with Peter, and it's this whole thing, he reels him in, and then bam, he goes after Peter and says, "You hypocrite." He writes, "I opposed him to his face." That's what Paul is doing in this writing. Now, it's very similar to some of the debates that we're having right now about Black Lives Matter, when people come and say, every life matters. Paul, in that context, would have said, yes, you're right. there are issues with this. Yes, of course, every life matters. Yes, of course. All of these things have incredible importance. Our police officers, all of it needs to be addressed. Our government, yes, all of it needs to be addressed. Yes, our people of color, our people who are not of color, the different organizations. Yes, it's political. Yes, it's overly social, blah, blah. Yes, yes, yes. And then, bam, he would have come back and said something like, if you can't say that black lives, people of color, are important, you're part of the problem. So that's sort of the approach that Paul would take. I bring that up mainly to help us understand this is the rhetorical writing style that Paul is using. And so if we're actually going to understand the Word of God, we have to get into the context that it was in then, and then we have to use sort of a contemporary version to help us understand how people are feeling, how these writings would have been received. It's why in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1, Paul is writing to the Corinthians in this fourth dialogue with the church, saying, yes, I'm timid when I'm face to face, but I write with severity when I'm not in person because you're not listening, you know. So anyways, but that's, I'm sharing that so that we can get in and understand the context. The emotional feelings that the church was having as they read and received this letter. We can't forget, Paul's writing to real people with real problems in a real time, talking to them about what it really means to follow Jesus and have our lives changed by Christ. It's just as real for us today as it was for them. So we have to understand how they're feeling. All right, so what really is at stake? Paul divides the argument into sort of the top half and the bottom half. He's talking about spiritual maturity. He's talking about wisdom and discernment. He's also talking about the Holy Spirit and the kingdom alignment. Not the king, not Caesar, not Herod, but the king of the world, Christ. So that's the context. So we have this idea of spiritual maturity. There's a couple of times that you'll notice the phrase "the mature" in these writings. There was this sense that there was some kind of special maturity level that this church in Corinth was writing to Paul and say, why didn't you give us the goods? Why didn't you give us the secrets to be the mature? Because obviously, the obvious connection then would be that there were people within the church of Corinth saying, oh, well, we have the special knowledge. So if you followed Paul, you didn't get it. If you would have followed one of our teachers, you would have gotten the special knowledge. So that's sort of the context of where we're at. Then there's this idea of wisdom and discernment. Again, it's a cultural thing. I remember a couple years ago, I'm dating myself now, but there was this book called The Secret. And it, you know, as you go and read self-help books or you kind of wander into that part of the library or bookstore, there's all of these things called the secret to getting rich, the secret to losing weight. So it's not that different for us. We have sort of this concept that we must, if we're not wealthy, rich, successful, famous, incredibly in perfect shape with the perfect family, then we must not know the secret, whether it's oils or a thought process or who knows what it is. We today still delve into this idea of if you get the secret information or the secret sauce, you'll get it. So that's the worldly argument. Then what Paul is doing is he's setting the stage and he's saying, no. What, guys, we're talking about the Holy Spirit. And I talked about the Holy Spirit with you. I told you about the Holy Spirit. I shared that content and information with you. I introduced you to the person of the Holy Spirit, and wisdom starts with the Holy Spirit. And then he's saying, kingdom alignment. One of the biggest arguments he's going to make is, why are you using worldly arguments? As we'll see later, the world killed Christ. It wasn't just the Jewish leaders. It was the Roman leaders. It was the entire people. Worldly wisdom gets you doesn't get you Jesus. So he's dividing it into these sections. So they need to stop looking worldly at this as well. This is what they're saying. This is what Paul is saying. All right, so basically, what's the argument? I've shared this a bunch. Hopefully, we'll get to the point where you're like, yeah, you've said that a bunch. But the argument is, Paul, why didn't you give us, see, here's this mature language. Why didn't you give us the special stuff? And then Paul, when he's, remember I said he does that whammy punch where then he comes at them full speed? It's 3-1. They're saying, why didn't you give us the stuff? And Paul says, because you babies. That's what he's saying. Why didn't you give us the special stuff? Because you're babies. You can't handle the truth. You know, so that's essentially, that's, I'm really dating myself now. This line, verse 3, chapter 3, verse 1, is the start of the clapback trap that Paul sets for the people. Paul's argument is there are not special teachers. Paul's argument is there are not special teachings. Paul's argument is, I gave you Jesus Christ and him crucified. You don't understand because you're not the mature. So that's what the argument's about. So what is wisdom for Paul? Let's keep backing up and kind of understand. Again, this all goes with verse 6. Just so you know, this is setting the stage. We do, however, speak a message of wisdom among the mature. What's godly wisdom? For Paul, godly wisdom has always been about building up the community. If you want to argue about wisdom, if you want to argue about your relationship with Christ, if you want to argue about advancing forward, it's always about building up the community. And he's going to come back to that in chapter 14, verse 12. Since you are eager for the gifts of the Spirit, try to excel in those that build up the church. In Ephesians 4, 13, until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. And then, of course, Romans 12, Philippians 3, Colossians 1. All of these are talking about wisdom is when you are working towards building up the community. Your gifts, your efforts, your life, building up the whole ecclesia, the whole church, the whole assembly, the whole faith. Then, what else does Paul teach? What does Jesus teach? What do we know about the message of wisdom? John chapter 16, verse 7 says, Jesus is telling his disciples, unless I go away, you won't have the Holy Spirit. See, this is what Paul's point is. You want special knowledge. It's not special knowledge. It's a special person, the person of the Holy Spirit coming into you. That's the only way to have wisdom and maturity, attaining the full measure of Christ, is to have the Holy Spirit. The wisdom, and like if we just would stop and think about this from just a simple perspective, just a simple argument. If we want spiritual wisdom, we know it's not coming from the earth. We get worldly wisdom from the earth. Like if we study the earth, we're going to have worldly wisdom. We're going to understand how grass grows or how cells divide or, you know, those things that we're talking about. That's worldly, earthly wisdom. But if we want spiritual wisdom, God created the world. He's in it, but he's not of it. Like, we're in it, we're not of it. He made it. He's outside of it. He's outside of the very reality of the world. So why would we look for answers in the world to get this essential spiritual wisdom? So like, Paul's just like, your argument to Corinthians, your argument doesn't make any sense. Why are you asking that question? Listen, here's where wisdom comes from. To know the cross of Jesus is to know wisdom. No cross, no wisdom. That's Paul's argument to the church. All right, let's keep going. So here it is. True wisdom belongs in the new age inaugurated by the cross of Christ. Right? At Eastside, we're about seeking Christ, serving the community, teaching others, joining worship. Number one, always, is we are about seeking Christ. When we talk about the ways that we look at Jesus, we say we are Christocentric. That means at the heart of everything is Jesus. When we study Scripture, we believe that Scripture is a unified story, Old and New Testament, start to finish, that points to the rule and reign of Jesus. Furthermore, Paul's argument is not just Christocentric, not just the Jesus is at the center, but it's cruciocentric. The cross is at the center. At the very heart of everything is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Now, the gospel is the incarnation, the life and teachings, the death on the cross, the resurrection from the dead after 3 days, and then the ascension to where He is at the right hand of the Father, interceding on our behalf, and the reality that He will come again to rule and reign. That's the whole gospel. That's all of it, not just a prayer. That's the whole true gospel. But that's at the very center, and it's Jesus Christ crucified that's at the very center. So if you want wisdom, it begins with Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And here's what's beauty. When we profess Christ, when we put our trust and our hope in Jesus, when we confess all of our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us of all unrighteousness, or forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. And then we also, as part of that, that cleaning of the house is making room and inviting the Holy Spirit into our lives. And it's the invitation and communion with the Holy Spirit that gives us wisdom. We can't get wisdom from anywhere else. We can learn and become smarter, and to some extent we can be wise. But when it comes to spiritual matters, wisdom comes from unity with the Holy Spirit within us, because that's just good theology. We know the Trinity, right? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are the same. They're one. Well, if the Holy Spirit is living within me, the Holy Spirit is one with the Father and with Jesus interceding at my behalf. And so in my very heart, where the Holy Spirit has, I've made room for the Holy Spirit. And when I stop and listen, I'm listening to the triune God whose reality is not of this world. And so I'm going to be filled with a wisdom that comes from outside of this world. That's true wisdom that Paul's saying to the church in Corinth. And as long as you're clamoring for some other kind of stuff, you're going to miss the clear voice of the Spirit within us. True wisdom belongs in the new age. It's inaugurated by the cross. It's the Holy Spirit falling on us like fire. All right, so that's the first half of the sermon. We're going to go through much quicker for the rest of this, but that's the point of Paul's argument. And I wanted to spend as much time as possible understanding Paul's argument, A, so that then the rest of this we can move through a bit quicker and go, oh, that's what he's saying, that's what he's saying. But B, more, you know, we have to then begin thinking about how do we interpret this for our lives? What does all this mean for us as a church in Harrisonburg, Virginia today? And I believe that God has a special request and emphasis on us, Eastside, and it's a time to move into sort of a new, it's probably the same for many of us, but moving into a deeper communion with God's wisdom through the power of the Holy Spirit. All right, we'll come to that. So, wisdom of the cross was foreordained and hidden. Essentially, Paul's argument, verse 7, no, we declare God's wisdom a mystery that has been hidden, and that God destined for our glory before time began. Essentially, the argument is just this. The cross was part of the plan even before the foundations of the world began. That's actually what this word means, destined. It's foreordained. Even before God made the earth, He knew that this was going to be the plan, and so that's what it is. So that's why we preach Christ crucified. The mature believers expect hardship. We expect to be surprised by the way the world treats us. We expect difficulty to come our way, and we shouldn't be worried about that. Worrying about those things are the habits of the world. We're the wisdom of the cross. And the cross, like this, the real cross for Jesus, the real cross for us. It's what it means to follow Jesus. So then Paul's moving into, okay, so how do we know wisdom? Know the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is triune, is part of God. I was going to say part of God. The Holy Spirit is God. So if we have the Holy Spirit whispering, nudging, that fire in our heart, pointing us, causing us to say certain things that make us uncomfortable or reach out to somebody or repent or confess, like the Holy Spirit in us, that is God. So if we want the wisdom of God, it's accepting and listening and practicing obedience to the Holy Spirit. That's the wisdom. And Paul's telling this group in Corinth who are arguing about special knowledge, he's like, I'm treating you like babies because you don't understand the simple truth that if you have the Holy Spirit, you have the only wisdom worth having. And who better to reveal the mind of God than God? No one knows your thoughts better than you. No one knows God's thoughts better than God's. That's the Holy Spirit within us. Praise God. Getting all fired up. All right, so here's the key to listening. Jumping to verses 10 to 13. Listening to the Spirit is key to maturity and wisdom. Guys, trying to find secret outside of God just reveals your ignorance. I remember when I was in seminary, sometimes I was mature and sometimes not, but I took a spiritual formation class. And I just remember being in there feeling like it was kind of a game. And, you know, I'm a fairly intuitive person because of my upbringing and childhood and all those kind of things. Like, I watch for cues and social things. And so without Jesus, I was able to point out things or say certain things. And for me, it just sort of felt like a game. But the more that I've been involved in healing ministry and the more that I've experienced healing and the more I've listened to the Holy Spirit, the more I realize, oh, my gosh, that was doing it in the flesh. It was a game. This is real life, and it's listening to the real Spirit. And when I stop in those moments of working with healing for other people and listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit, that's when real wisdom, that's when real change happens. You know, and it's a challenge. We have to continue to learn and grow and develop in that, but listening to the Spirit's the key to wisdom. The people whose voices I trust the most are the ones who listen, share what the Holy Spirit is saying to them. Don't add and don't take away. They don't take away the parts that they're worried might offend you, and they don't add their own explanations to it. Listening to the Spirit is the key to maturity. Yeah, all right, keep going. All right, 14 to 16, kingdom mindset. We understand the world, but the world cannot understand us. I just want to read this passage because this is one of those passages that sometimes people... If we're not careful, this becomes a really messed up theological point. 14 to 16. The person without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, but considers them foolish and can't understand them because they are discerned only through the Spirit. That's what I just mentioned. Verse 15. The person with the Spirit makes judgment about all things, but such a person is not subject to merely human judgments. The person with the Spirit makes judgments about all things, but such a person is not subject to merely human judgments. Okay, that's not saying that as Christians we are not held accountable within the body of Christ. That's simply saying that when we make decisions to follow Jesus, the decisions we make won't be understood by the world. If somebody quits a job that is a higher pay and takes a job that's lower pay, that doesn't make sense to the world. But that if they're listening to the Spirit, that's spiritual wisdom. So they're not subject to the judgment of the world. Of course, we're subject to the judgment of the church. Otherwise, Matthew 18 doesn't make sense. Otherwise, the rest of 1 Corinthians, when Paul's talking about what we do when somebody's sinning blatantly, like that wouldn't make sense. So this is specifically saying, guys, when you start making decisions, and I remember going to seminary, I didn't experience a lot of support from some people. And I just remember saying, hey, it's better to have one day in God's courts than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather take the praise of God than the praise of men. And so that's all that this passage matters, is when we are in the kingdom, the decisions we make are judged by God, our king, not by the kings of this world. All right, keeping moving. Chapter 3, 1-4, where he's pulling the rug out from them right here. Paul's bringing it home. You complained about my teachings. It was you that failed. You wanted more than Jesus, more than his spirit. Have there ever been moments in your life, this is where it comes home for us too, right? Have there ever been moments in your life where you wanted something more than Jesus? Like, you're like, somebody gave you the, you're going through a difficulty and somebody says something that you know is spiritually true and you're like, yeah, but that's not the answer I'm looking for right now. It happens to all of us, right? Paul's telling them, guys, the problem isn't that I didn't tell you. The problem isn't that we don't know where to look. The problem is you don't want to look where you know to look. You want something other than Jesus. That's called idolatry. Like, just at the base definition, we often think of idolatry as going out into the woods and dancing around a pole and something like that, you know, and worshiping it. I mean, that was idolatry, and still is today. But idolatry is choosing something and putting something of greater value, which is worship, value, worship, over God, to want something other than God. Paul's reminding them, you guys wanted the secret more than Jesus. And on top of that, if that's not bad enough, you're quarreling about this. You guys are arguing. This word quarrel is strife, a readiness to quarrel, having a contentious spirit, affection for dispute. Now, full confession, I do love a good argument. This is something that I have to work at in my own spirit. When I'm fired up about something, sometimes I'm just looking for someone to kick, okay? That's not the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ, as we talked about in our last sermon series, Exiles, is a robust learning community where we can really talk about the issues without getting personally offended all the time, without using worldly wisdom to understand a church issue. Guys, I can tell you right now, the church world, unfortunately, is often dominated by worldly wisdom more than spiritual wisdom. One of the greatest, I just got to be honest with you guys right now, one of the greatest frustrations for Pastor Matt and I is in some of the settings where we find ourselves in, there is a contentious spirit. We are trying to solve issues of faithfulness with worldly logic, worldly leadership, worldly understanding. And if it was simply a matter of looking at Scripture and saying, okay, well, I'm seeing this and you're seeing this, that would be one thing. But what's happening in the church, sometimes at Eastside, in the broader church, certainly in the church of North America, the United States, oh my gosh, how often are we using worldly wisdom to make these arguments? Well, the government says this, so we have to do this. The government says we can't open, so we can't open. The government says we can't open, so we have to open. The government can't tell us what to do. The government, da, da, da. Like, where is spiritual wisdom in all of that? Guys, this is, here it is. I'm going to go there this morning because I feel like this is what God's calling us to. As I was praying about this, I had written some of these things down, and God kind of was like, I tested it with some brothers in the church, and they had some positive, some, you know. I think I'm just going to read what I wrote down, because this is what I feel like God's calling Eastside. This is what I feel like God's calling Eastside to. I think this is an important time for us as a church. We're getting a building. That's big. But our body is also being built. Guys, we are called to reflect the city where we find ourselves. And that means God is moving us and has work to do in us to become a diverse fellowship that reflects the city where we find ourselves. Where we love one another. Where we talk about the important issues. Man, when Paul's writing this letter to the church, they're talking about really big stuff. It's not unimportant, trivial issues. It is key societal, systemic issues. And I believe God is calling us to be a different kind of community, a different kind of body, a different kind of church, where we have work to do to make space for that. So, one of the things that I feel called to talk to us about this morning, as I'm reflecting on Paul, as I'm reflecting about this letter, can we, as a church, talk about sin without falling into our personal freedom narratives? Can we talk about guns without going into an NRA and a left-wing dispute? Can we talk about violence without these issues stemming up? Can we correct a Republican president for his obvious racism and connection to systemic white supremacy without getting our Republican self in a knot? Can we talk about a Democratic president who wrote a bill, three strikes and you're out, that was deliberately affecting and incarcerating mass numbers of people of color without getting our Democratic side a bunch? Can we make a simple comment? Man, what our president just said was racist. It was not helpful. It was not Christian. Without going, oh, well, you know what your president said, and you know, da, da, da. Can we say Black Lives Matter without being concerned about, oh, well, it's a socialist organization, or, oh, it's, yes, all lives matter. Well, it's anti-cop, or it's... Can we just say that people of color matter without getting into this whole mumbo-jumbo? And at the same point, can we talk about these issues without lobbing political grenades or socialized grenades at one another? Can we actually be a robust learning community? Because I'm telling you right now, our children are watching, and we do a wonderful job at Eastside of raising our kids. You just go and listen to the prayers that are prayed in Eastside Kids. Our children have a spiritual depth and maturity because we've modeled that. But if they see us fighting about politics in a way that's not biblical, not guided by the Holy Spirit, they're going to go, I'm getting too fired up. They're going to ask us, why do politics matter more than Jesus to you? If we're not going to talk about systemic issues of race without going, well, yeah, the Irish were treated bad too, our kids are going to go, what are you talking about? I thought Jesus was Lord. It seems to me that other issues are Lord for you as a church. Now, I am not, please hear me, church. I love you. I'm not mad at Eastside. Not at all. I am mad at myself for the ways that my eyes have been closed. I'm mad at the world that we live in, where I can get a speeding ticket going 20 miles an hour over in a national park and I got a park violation. And a friend of mine who's African American got a speeding ticket for going 5 over and lost his license for 6 months. That's not right. And if we can't talk about this, if we can't talk about those issues without getting our politics and our idolatry all stirred up, then we're not following Jesus, and we're the very immature that Paul was talking about. Guys, I know this church. I know you. Man, I've sat with so many of us. Man, I love this church. I love it. I love you. And I know that we can be the kind of people that listen to the discerning voice of the Holy Spirit. We can be the kind of people where somebody votes Republican and somebody votes Democrat, and they talk about spiritual issues, and they love each other, and they don't start lobbing grenades at one another. I believe that's what God is calling us. I believe God is calling us to not be right, not be left. I believe God is calling us down the middle of the kingdom highway. The world too long, and especially the church, has fallen on the right and the left, literally, politically, figuratively. We've also fallen into these patterns of puffed up knowledge, knowing Greek and Hebrew and the five spiritual laws and the Romans road, and not caring about the poor or people of color in our community. Or we have this zealous activism on the other side. I didn't mean to put them on the right and left. That was an accident. But we have this zealous activism where it's all about action, it's all about power, it's all about fighting, and oh yeah, if we talk about Jesus, that's nice too. But this is a worldly way to solve. Both of these are worldly ways to solve problems that can only be solved by spiritual obedience to Christ. And that's the letter Paul is writing to the church in Corinth. And that's the letter that I believe this is the kind of church that Eastside already, guys, you are already becoming. You wouldn't be here if you weren't ready for this. If your heart wasn't already stirred toward this. I've had enough conversations with so many of you that what you love and what's drawing you is this unique opportunity to literally be the hands and feet of Christ and push aside political crap. Sorry, kids. Push aside the junk in order to focus on the wisdom of Jesus. And I believe that's what God's calling us to right now. And that begins with, for many of us, it begins with repentance. It begins with saying, yes, Lord, I wanted earthly wisdom and power and authority more than I wanted spiritual obedience. Man, I wanted a quick fix. I wanted to cover up something more than I wanted to go through chemo treatment. I need you to do a deep work in my life. And I know that right now I feel like I want to have a quick answer. I want to solve the problem immediately. But I need you to do a deep work in me before I can continue to be part of the solution, part of the redemptive plan, more than just contributing to things, getting fired up, shooting a tweet, Facebook, or destroying a personal relationship with someone. That's who I believe God is calling us. And we're called to reflect the city. And I keep wondering sometimes, maybe the reason that we aren't fully yet reflecting the city is I have work to do. We have work to do. God has work to do in our eyes. So, church, how do we do this? We'll wrap up here. How do we do this? Paul's message to the church in Corinth and his message to us today is so simple. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Have a crucio-centric understanding of life. Right? It's coming to Jesus, repenting, confessing, putting our trust in him. And so often in the world, it ends right there. We pray the sinner's prayer, but the next part is fundamental to maturity. We should pray the prayer. We should confess our sins. God is faithful and just. But if we just clean the house out, Jesus reminds us, if we get rid of stuff and we don't invite the Holy Spirit to make his dwelling among us, this very heart then we leave it empty for something much more powerful or worse to come in. Let's fix our eyes on Jesus. So what needs to happen to have the mind of Christ? I'm going to just spend some time in prayer. And if the Holy Spirit is speaking to you today, I trust the Holy Spirit is speaking to us today. I don't want to be arrogant, but the Holy Spirit is speaking to me as I've been preparing for this. And I believe that the Holy Spirit is speaking to us. And I've had enough conversations with many of you that the Holy Spirit's already at work in you over some of these issues. And some of you have seen them before I am, right? So I'm going to pray. And if it's you, pray with me. And if it's not you, pray for someone around you who's in that area, who needs to continue that relationship with Christ. Guys, we want people to come to know Jesus. And we want to come and know Jesus. So let's pray. Holy Spirit, come with power. Come with fire. Break down the walls of hostility and division, disunity, mistrust at Eastside. God, we want you and nothing less. God, help us to also say we want you, nothing more. Holy Spirit, fill us. For those who haven't made a decision to follow Christ, it's this simple. Lord, I confess I'm a sinner. I confess that all this striving, all this work, all this stuff that I'm doing on my own isn't getting me to the joy and the peace that I want. And I know that the only joy and peace I can have is you. And you went to the cross for my sins in order that I might have life, Lord. And I confess now, I trust you for that result in my life. And now that I've confessed my sin, my shame, I ask you, Holy Spirit, to fill my heart. Holy Spirit, fill our hearts to overflowing, that we would burst forth with tears, that we would burst forth with song, that we would burst forth in the special prayer language that you give some of us, that we would burst forth in spiritual gifts, that we would burst forth in unity and repentance and the mindset of the triune God of the universe, who there's nothing that is that wasn't made by you. You always were, you are, and you always will be. Holy Spirit, fall afresh on us, your church. God, don't let us go anywhere that you're not sending us. Don't let us say anything that you're not telling us. Don't let us manufacture false repentance. Let us speak repentance that's from the heart that you stir up so that you can push out of us. God, we need you. God, we're not going any. Help us, Lord, help me, help us to say, I'm not going anywhere unless you're going with us. I'm not saying anything unless you say it to me. I don't want to be anyone that you don't want me to be. I don't want to chase goals that you haven't given me. I don't want to speak words that you haven't spoken to me. God, help us. We love you. Amen. Love you guys. I'll see you next time.